special guest with your host, Lady Grace. Now let's get started.
Everybody, hi, how y'all doing today? Bon dia, bon siman, blessed week. Yeah, time for the breakfast lounge, of course. Thank you all for tuning in, and of course, for those of you who have been tuned in since 7 o'clock this morning, thank you for sticking around. I also want to send a big shout out to Premier Dr. Ellis Lorenzo Webster, the Premier of Anguilla. Big shout out to you, Anguilla. Thank you guys so much for tuning in every day. You know, my family's from Anguilla too.
Same here.
Sandy Grong.
That's right.
Sandy Grong, good morning. And of course, to the other parts in Anguilla, of course, pleasant good morning to each and every one of you. Thank you all so very much for tuning in here each and every morning. And joining me this morning in the breakfast lounge, of course, like I mentioned on Friday and even earlier this morning, is caretaker Minister of Justice, Minister Anna Richardson, will be joining me for the full hour here this morning. Minister, good morning and welcome. It's been a while.
A pleasant good morning to you and blessed week, Bonsiman.
Uh-huh.
To you, your listeners, and everyone who is bushy-tailed this morning. Bright-eyed and bushy-tailed.
Bushy-haired this morning. I got up this morning. I said, I'm going to do this here because it's full moon.
Yeah.
So I clipped it. I had it trimmed yesterday. You know, yes. The best time to trim it, is when it's a full moon. Mm-hmm. And then you trim it, and then I just got it, and I just put some conditioner in it.
And it looks beautiful.
Out the door. Thank you. Yours does, too. I like the way how you actually does do that.
Yeah, that's what they complimented on that.
Sometimes. I like that. You got to teach me that skill. Okay. Anyhow, Minister,
yes.
Let's first and foremost, we have a lot to talk about this morning. I know these are just basically somewhat of a countdown for your final days in office. And because I think you got an additional 3 months to sit in office, you along with the other ministers, of course. Now, first and foremost, you have recently signed off. We're going to start off, of course, with the LBs for law enforcement officers.
Yes.
I know they're listening. They do every morning.
Yes. Good morning to them.
All right. Now, you have recently signed off on numerous LBs for law enforcement officers in the justice chain concerning mainly the new salary scales, which has been a great achievement so far. Mm-hmm. Now, Minister, now if you can highlight for us approximately how many more of those Lanba slates are still to be signed off? And do you feel that this process is something that will be achieved before you leave office?
Thank you for the question, Grace. So finalized is not a word that we would want to use at this time because there are phases in this process. And we are in phase one. Phase one is the issuance or distribution of or signing off the Lanba baccalaureates are national decrees per individual, and we're talking about 500 plus. So the ministry has almost 800, but of those, 500 plus are active, and we are dealing with those active now. Mm-hmm. Those active LBAs that we're distributing is, we refer to it sort of like stopping the bleed, because you know that on a daily basis, monthly basis, that debt continued to grow as long as we didn't bring a stop to it. So we recognize when the calculations were complete that there's about $44.5 million in debt that the country has to the officers or the personnel of justice, right? So the first and initial approach was to phase one to be able to stop that. So they're receiving national decrees that recognizes from January 2023, which is when the book in itself would be active, to present day. So as time goes, each person who receives their national decrees as we go, they're going to be getting a retroactive payment between that date and January 2023. So there's already a retroactive payment in there. once phase one is done, we're going to move into phase two. And phase two is when we really get into that retroactive from anyone who is employed with the ministry from 10-10-10 and would have been hired in between there, that the function book and the requisiti and the new police scales, all of these things were not in place. So the first step was in December of last year. We were able to have that legal basis established. Mm-hmm. And then now we're issuing those national decrees per individual. We've signed 44 of those thus far. So that's two packages. And now we're going into package three. I'm hoping to sign those on Wednesday, this Wednesday. Mm-hmm. We had a delay with it because one, His Excellency had to travel, but then we finally received the LBA. So I'm grateful to the fact that he signed those before traveling. But then we had the budget. So that too, in preparation for that, kind of slowed us down. But this Wednesday, we are trying to secure a location because we have some renovations happening at the building as well. But secure the location, send the invitation to the next 25 persons who are to come, sign with those, and then return to answering questions for the budget, because we go to Parliament tomorrow for the budget. So I'm hoping to sign those off with them on Wednesday morning, and that would be batch three. Batch four has also been sent off to the Ministry of Finance, and we're trying to keep that rhythm going. Being able to finalize phase one before I depart office might be kind of a stretch, but we're trying to do our best. The idea here is to keep it going, keep it a systematic circulation going in terms of getting those packages through to the Ministry of Finance and then to the governor and back to the minister. And the only hope is that whomever is coming in, whoever the successor is for the Ministry of Justice, will maintain that rhythm and will allow each person to obtain their national decrees.
Which, how much is actually earmarked for each phase, financially speaking, of course?
Well, so the earmark is $5 million annually. So every budget year, we have budgeted $5 million guilders towards the retroactive payments. Certain sectors within justice are entitled to retroactive payments, some are not. Mm-hmm. But then when it comes to the function book in itself, that in itself has retroactive payment built into it, because the scaling to each salary or the scaling to each position carries financial weight. So there's a difference between what you should have been making to what you were making, and you're entitled to that payment.
The accuracy of these scalings now, how was that calculated?
So there is certified in companies within the Dutch kingdom who is allowed to do such service. So describe a function and then weigh it. Mm-hmm. FUWA is what they use for that. The acronym as to what it stands for specifically, I'm sorry, I can't provide that to you. But you have to be FUWA certified in order to be able to execute this function. And we started off with an institution called Balance that is based in Curacao. Mm-hmm. But we had some challenges with them because they did not necessarily agree with certain scales for department heads. And that was like a back and forth situation, because too often individuals who are involved in this process likes to couple the Ministry of Justice into the administrative services, and justice is not an administrative service. You have to respect justice, that it is the one ministry that is tasked with going into risky situations when everybody else would run from it.
Okay.
Yeah, we have support staff, that is our administrative staff, and yes, they fall under, let's say, the LMA, you know, that is an administrative structure. But for the most part, we know that the requisiti or the police law recognizes police tasks. And so you have to respect that the level of risk that individuals within the Ministry of Justice are subjected to, other ministries are not. And so we've experienced too many individuals who really are just set in their own understanding and the way they feel that this ministry needs to be set up, and it goes against our operation.
Are you talking about the unions here?
No, not necessarily the unions, because the unions in particular recognizes the uniqueness of justice. Mm-hmm. But I'm talking about individuals like I mentioned, if you have to deal with an institution that that is FUWA certified,
right,
they need to be able to understand that though FUWA is more so an administrative platform and format, mm-hmm. a formula, let me say that,
right.
that you use, it is not necessarily applicable to the structure and operations of the Ministry of Justice. You have your challenges there in a sense. So we had to switch to a different company.
All right. One of the questions I hear a lot of the justice workers actually asking is, where is the money?
The money's there. The money's there, and as a matter of fact, this pay period, there are individuals from batch 19 that can state that they've started to receive their monies. Okay. You know what I mean? It is now that you're getting your LBAs, you'll start to see your money. So this misconception that many politicians have tried to bring to justice workers, the money isn't there, it's absolutely incorrect. They try to make it seem like as though the announcement and the signing was all a political stunt. But you know what? I stay focused. I really can't be concerned about those kinds of games. And to this day, someone said to me this morning, you're the hardest working the missionary minister I've seen. You know, I've never seen a minister that stayed so dedicated and kept it going. Of course, mm-hmm. until my last day in office, I'm going to continue to push work and it be done, because it was never about me. It has always been about the justice workers. And I stated that on several platforms. Some might not have liked the way I've stated it, but I've stayed true to my word. Mm-hmm. And I have seen to it that it got completed, and we're going to continue to do it until day zero.
All right. Now that the function book, according to you, Minister Richardson, that it's completed now, there can be no alterations, sort of nothing can be changed. I mean, even after you leave office.
Nothing can be reversed.
Basically.
Nothing can be reversed. Okay. I've even heard about individuals stating that they're going to halt and they're going to stop and this and that. That's going to be to the detriment of them, trust mm-hmm. me. But what the function book is it's not stone, right? The only thing that you want to do with this function book is upgrade it. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe you have a new sector within a department that's coming, so you need to describe those positions. Those are the types of positive changes that could come to the function book. It's just about enhancement.
Right.
But this notion of trying to give persons the impression that what we have done successfully is incorrect and you're going to halt it, and that type of stuff is, you know, think about the people that this affects. It's not just politics that you're playing, but you're playing with individuals' lives, you know, and that is emotionally, financially, it's draining.
All right. How many departments are we talking about here?
Nine. Within the Ministry of Justice, we have nine. I must state that one of the departments that is extremely eager about recognizing that they are a part of this process is the Court of Guardianship, as well as our Executive Protection Unit. Those two units, we're waiting and we're hoping this week we're going to receive the advice from the Council of Advice, because I'm really hoping that prior to me leaving office, I can submit the LIOL, which is the governing structure of the Ministry of Justice. Mm-hmm. It is where all of the departments within justice is officially recognized. I need to send that to Parliament so that they can approve the official incorporation now of the Court of Guardianship that currently functions as a foundation under the umbrella of justice.
Okay.
But in this manner now, once it's approved by Parliament, it'll be an official department within the Ministry of Justice.
Wow.
Same thing for the Executive Protection Unit. This unit, of course, established within the kingdom in all our sectors of government, provides that level of security detail for Prime Minister, ministers, His Excellency the Governor, mm-hmm. Chair of Parliament. So we are looking forward to submitting that to Parliament prior to my departure, I'm hoping.
That's an additional financial burden on the ministry, though.
It already exists.
Wow.
We're not adding anything that's going to bring new financial costs.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, the Executive Protection Unit has been in the pipeline for quite a number of years, quite a number of administrations. And it's only now that it has officially been added to the LIOL and is going through the proper legal structure and process. The Department of Court of Guardianship has been a foundation, a stick thing that is established under the Ministry of Justice, functioning all the time, financed all the time, or subsidized, but now it's coming into the formation of the ministry.
All right. Now, Minister, the working relationship between French and the Dutch side officials is something that is gaining more visibility and traction because of an agreement between both administrations on the island. With that said, how far does this working relationship extend, basically in terms of what is allowed and what is not surrounding cross-border scenarios?
Yeah, well, compliments to both sides for in ensuring that the fact that we have open borders, the idea and the reality of working together only benefits both, because the simplicity and ease of persons just being able to move cross-border after committing crimes or doing wrong is something that we have to tighten, and they should not feel that it's okay too. But of course, communication is the key in this. Mm-hmm. We still have to communicate to each other when we're crossing over.
Correct.
And we still need to be able to respect mm-hmm. the fact that, you know, the territories and the jurisdictional authority mm-hmm. still stands. I know that the entities are trying to work as close as possible. Of course, the structure on the French side is quite different to the Dutch side.
Correct.
Because with our autonomy, we make our decisions here.
Mm-hmm.
However, they have to send up their decisions, and sometimes that takes a while for answers to come through. However, thus far, the cooperation has been quite fruitful for both sides, and I want to just give compliments to the fact that we are seeing that our authorities in justice are working together.
Right. Now, Minister, I want to touch on something very delicate here, I should
sure.
say, or very something that we've seen over the past few months, actually, that's been popping up in the news constantly, child protection.
Yeah.
Child protection laws, where we see that, child molestation is
yeah.
on the rise in the country,
yeah.
rather, and the laws actually that the perpetrators are actually, the punishment that they're actually receiving is a minimal sentence, a light sentence.
Mm-hmm.
How can we go about making changes to this law?
The Penal Procedure Code is one that has been lingering for quite some time. The Parliament of Sint Maarten did receive it, and they did take quite a long time to review it. They had some aspects of it that they wanted changed. That change was submitted to the Ministry of Justice. However, the professor that is responsible for having draft that with a team has been pending to come to Parliament to be able to discuss these changes with, to bring some clarity, because it's a uniform law between Sint Maarten, Aruba, and Curaçao,
mm-hmm.
And the Netherlands. Yeah, it's a uniform law. And Sint Maarten is, I believe, we're the only ones that is pending to finalize ours, and it's on hold for some time. I'm hoping that this parliament would see to it that the professor does come in, answers the questions that they want, and we can get it. Because the new Penal Procedure Code does have some more stringent penalties for these types of crimes.
Yeah. Now, Minister, can you walk us through the process that culminated into the Ministry of Justice seeing their first official Secretary General of the
mm-hmm.
Ministry? And in addition to that, how did this only happen now?
So, I love the way you ask that.
You
know, positions are published quite often. And the interesting thing about positions being published is that oftentimes we do not see the influx of response or reaction that we would like. And so you put the position out, maybe persons misunderstood the description or the weight and responsibility. So once you get into the first discussion, then they're like, oh, I recant. This is not something that I thought it was, etc. And the word secretary in itself is, you know, a lot of people misunderstand, like I said, the weight of it. So we've had this position published several times through my tenure. We have had a lot of persons acting in this position. However, when the position was published, those same persons who were acting never applied. So you find
okay.
that kind of weird as well, because if you held an acting position and you wanted to remain in that,
mm-hmm.
why not apply for the position when it's published? Didn't happen. Nevertheless, I did secure the services of SORB. And I do believe there were a few persons that went through that process. And the now Secretary General is the only one that I've seen in acting position that actually put forth an application and said, hey, listen, I'm acting in a position right now, but I think that I can carry this. So she applied. And she went through this entire process with Esoabe, and she was the successor of this this process.
So one might ask, yeah, but they're already in that position already. Why have them reapply or apply for the position?
No, you have to. Being
it's
an acting,
mandatory.
Being in an acting position does not automatically constitute you to be the person for it.
Okay.
At the end of the day, you know, we have to remember that we have political roles, and we do have a lot of persons who have taken up positions or have been placed in positions that might not necessarily be adequate for the position, and that sometimes brings a stagnation into your operations. And I like to follow things accordingly to make sure that that type of influence is not a part of someone taking up a role, because ultimately, even though I am, you know, temporary in a position, and when I say temporary, you do this for 4 years, I want the Ministry of Justice to always function optimal. Yeah. So putting this process through SOABE is one where there is a professional approach. There is no political influence there. And they are, you know, in a very corporate style, doing interviews and recognizing who would be the best fit for a position of this caliber.
Right.
So I'm happy that Miss Maarten was successful in capturing this position. I think that she has been doing a wonderful job, and I bid the ministry much success with her in this capacity.
What does her function actually entail?
So she is the second in command,
right.
To the minister. And she actually has the role and responsibility of working directly with the department heads. So technically, when we're talking about planning, you're talking about year plans, you're talking about execution, all of this, the department heads are actually supposed to report to the secretary general. And she reports to the minister of justice. So her and the minister have to do planning together, and she has to see that the minister's vision as well is executed. But it's not a light task at all.
Okay.
It's
right.
Not being, you know, second in command. Yeah.
Yeah. I want to get back to the child protection law, basically.
Sure.
I know that the court of guardianship, actually, this is something that they actually are handling, but how can we go about actually making it a priority? Or pushing to make this law become, you know, basically to become law, actually, to enforce this law in the country, because we cannot continue to see, and I'm sure a lot of people out here are saying, like, yeah, thank you, Lady Grace, for pushing this.
Absolutely.
You know, because we cannot continue to see where young girls, children actually, are being molested by the person that they trust.
Yeah.
And then to just have them receive a slap on the wrist and walk away.
Absolutely. And this has been happening for way too long. You know what I mean? And it's good that individuals are being brave enough to come forward with it.
Mm-hmm.
Despite you might not be pleased with the outcome or the length of penalty that the person gets, still speak up. Still allow something to happen, because the more it becomes aware that this is happening, the more the enforcement of protection can be. If you don't know, then you're not able to apply it. So I do believe that awareness, continuing to expose these individuals, is necessary. Like you said, the Court of Guardianship takes this very serious.
Mm-hmm.
The minister as well has to be someone that is championing for that to happen. But the penal procedure code, we need to see that pass law. So once that happens, that enforcement is going to be better.
We're depending on who to push this law, actually.
Parliament has to pass this law.
Okay.
It's already in Parliament's hands. Parliament did submit it to, like I said, the Ministry of Justice.
Right.
And we want a professor who has seen or spearheaded this committee to have this done to come to Sint Maarten. He's on standby waiting to do so.
Where's he coming from?
I have to double check. I don't want to give the wrong location, but I do believe it's the Netherlands.
Okay.
That he is based. But we've been following up with Parliament to see the best date. But of course, it was happening very close to election and the change, etc.
Mm-hmm.
But we continue to request for a new date to be given to us so
right.
we can be invited.
Yeah, it needs to be done post haste.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Now, Minister, humanitarian support, let's talk about that. We see with the ongoing civil war in Haiti, what steps are being taken. We see Haitian nationals that is something that is a hot topic, not only in St. Martin, but globally. Mm-hmm. You see, for example, in France, where they're actually asking their citizens to, well, I think the Dutch are asking their citizens to register. France now is looking for ways to get their citizens out of Haiti. Now, even to the point where an MP from the House of Parliament requested your input in the matter. With that, Minister, break down for us what you and by extension the ministry is doing on this front, or if at all, how are you accessing this situation and how do you intend to extend a helping hand if at worst case a scenario should present itself? Talking about deportation or whatever it takes, how are we protecting these nationals who are currently in St. Martin?
So they're here, and it's a case where the Foreign Affairs is the institution within the Ministry of General Affairs that gives indication as to the severity of situations with territories, whether there is a case that deportation is allowed, not allowed, etc. So the Ministry of Justice, being Immigration Department in specific, has that consultation with General Affairs and Foreign Affairs. Now, is the objective to deport persons? The objective of the Immigration Department is never first instance to want to deport persons. What they ask and what we've been asking is, while you're here on the island, just make yourself legal. Apply for what you know is necessary to be a legal resident on the island. We have a lot of persons that come to St. Martin on boat, so they did not come in through a legal avenue. And we have to deal with those instances. Now, in a crisis situation that's going on in Haiti, according to what is being communicated, I haven't gotten any confirmation on it, but I've heard that the airport is non-functional. That's what I've heard. I've heard that the government is non-functional. Again, but Foreign Affairs has not provided us with any official statements in those lines. Mm-hmm. By extension to that, we've had instances where these matters have gone before the courts, and the courts have ruled that the person is in violation. They have ordered for them to go back because they've stated that Haiti is a big territory, and it's a case where there's the capital in particular that is having this issue, not the entirety of the country. So to use that, according to the courts, is not a premise that they were prepared to rule in favor of the individual saying to stay. Nothing wrong with you being, as a matter of fact, the MP himself indicated along the lines of individuals who are born in St. Maarten, right, to parents who may not have filed and so were considered illegal on the island. File. Myself and the MP had this conversation in person in Parliament, both on the floor and off. And I said to him, listen, there are individuals that may have language barrier or for whatever reason, there might be a sense of fear. Assist them. Assist them to apply. We have to stop making government be the problem in the situation and recognize that there is opportunity for you to be able to support these individuals by assisting them to apply. And you know what? In our community, we know that there are persons who will use the vulnerability of these individuals, will take hard-earned money from them and won't file. And individuals know these and won't go to the police department and file a fraud suit against these individuals. But you blame government. Looking for government to do a blanket approach is not the way that we should look at this, because whether we want to acknowledge this or not, St. Maarten is densely populated, right? And we have over 120 different nationalities that has made St. Maarten home. If you're going to block it for one nationality, understand that you have to block it for every other nationality that would seek it, because then you're being prejudiced. Yes? But assist the individuals who are in need of applying for proper residency. That's all we can say.
So if someone is found, a Haitian national, of course, is found that he or she does not have the legal documentation, what happens then?
To date, we haven't received anything that says that they cannot be deported. The objective, as I said, is not to deport. We would want everyone who has made St. Maarten their home, legally, of course, to be here. You know, Sint Maarten is a beautiful country. Everybody loves it. But we just got to do things the right way. That's all. And that's all we've been saying.
Right.
But like I said, we have not to date received anything official that advises different. So the immigration department would need to officially receive something that advises the status in Haiti to know what we can and cannot do.
So we did not receive any notice from the UN?
Nothing at all? Not yet.
Okay.
Not yet.
All right. Now, Minister, let's talk about your tenure as Justice Minister,
sure.
which is approaching an end.
Mm-hmm.
Is there one thing that you had hoped to achieve during your term that you did not manage to get accomplished?
The Law Enforcement Institute of Sint Maarten. That is the institution where our men and women of justice, be it frontline or administrative support, would go for their uplearning, their education and training. We have the lot of land in Cold Bay, right next to Carlinson, where Surima once stood. That is designated for that institution to be established. It's very important because education is key. Education gives our officers and our support staff that administrative or support to know how to execute and to get those refresher courses that they would need so they can be optimal in their service line within our community.
Mm-hmm.
But what I did manage to do was re-establish a relationship with the Orve Institute in Curacao. That's the police school that our law enforcement officers attended prior to the Justice Academy coming to line. But the Justice Academy had been damaged, and it did go through some challenges because it was not an accredited institution.
Mm-hmm.
The instructors might have been accredited, but that's not how accreditation works. So there were some challenges there. Nevertheless, I would have liked to have the institution established. But the MOU that has been signed is introducing online courses for our staff. And so I look forward to our HR department carrying that through so that staff can start to log on online and get those refresher course certification, etc.
Does the budget also for the Ministry of Justice also include a prison, construction of a prison?
Oh, it does. There's even a figure. I can't give you what that amount is off my top of my head right now, but there's a figure within our CapEx budget that is towards the prison. But we do have to look for some additional funds because I do believe that the official figure to build our prison is going to be released pretty soon. But that figure has not been finalized. We did ask for it to, you know, be capped off because if you continue to talk about needing this and needing that,
mm-hmm.
that figure goes up. So we did discuss about capping that off. And once we have that officially, the minister would be able to announce what it's going to cost our prison to be built.
All right. What about rehabilitation in the prison?
All of that is coming along in the new structure. All of that is coming along in the new structure to be able to have...
Better?
Yes, okay. I think so.
Okay, all right.
All of that is coming along to be able to ensure that the new facility that is coming on board is going to be optimal in its purpose,
mm-hmm.
yeah? Persons coming into prison, the idea is not to have recidivism. It's when you leave, we want you to leave on a very high note. I want to take this moment to say congratulations to Lexi if he is viewing right now. But Lexi is a former inmate of Point Blanche Prison that is now producing
oh, yes.
a book.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes, I read about that.
Yes.
I'd like to have him here in the
That would be great, I think. He has been doing some Radio Blitz, so
mm-hmm.
I'm really, really proud of him. He is a music producer. He's writing books. He has a cleaning service. He is doing so well. Phenomenal. And I'm super proud of him. So just coming back you know, he spent some 19 years incarcerated, and he's talking about that. He's talking about the good things that, well, the experience in itself.
It was like 19 years of your life, behind bars.
Yeah. But it made him a very wise person,
mm-hmm.
and it made him a mature person. And I see that he is using that experience to do just what we wanted to do with Have a Bay Unscripted. I don't know if you've ever gotten to see it. But Have a Bay Unscripted, you know, is of inmates, as former inmates,
mm-hmm.
that talk about their upbringing, the circumstances, the choices choices that they made that landed them, unfortunately, in Harvey Bay or in Point Blanche Prison. And some of them took that opportunity to become skillful in certain things, be it in sewing, craft, cutting hair, maintenance, so many different things. And then we have the GED program going on right now, you know, and Dr. Boston always tells me, don't just mention GED, you know, emphasize the fact that it is about literacy, the development in one's ability to be able to read, to write, to count, mm-hmm. to be independent. And for those individuals who would feel like, yeah, but even if I do my GED and, you know, I go out, I'm not getting a job, that's okay. You can be an entrepreneur. You know, it's just about believing in yourself. And our probation department, SCAIS, they are currently doing a program right now to build that self-esteem, build that confidence, manage your anger, manage rejection. Because not a lot of people are, there are some persons mm-hmm. who can't deal with being told no. And so, you know, within the facility itself, there's a lot of great programs going on. People learning how to cook, people learning how to sew. Mm-hmm. You know, the GED, as I mentioned, and we have a gentleman right now who wants to bring forward an entrepreneurship program to them. And what I said to him was, yes, the entrepreneurship is good. We can look into that, see who's interested. But let's not forget those who are not, you know, of the position that I'm a business owner. Maybe I just want to be a staff, but I need to learn how to maintain employment. And sometimes it's just about having proper manners. Good morning, good afternoon, thank you, please. You know, with the respect. A lot of our persons within, even with general community, we tend to have this entitlement mm-hmm. behavior about us. I from here. Kind of thing, you know?
Yes.
And it's good. We from here. It's good to be patriotic and it's good to be proud to be from here. But at the same time, you have to have a level of respect, especially when you're going into someone else's establishment mm-hmm. and saying, I need employment. I need to make an honest living. And can I do that through your institution? More than likely, they'll be welcoming. Resume writing, being able to write a proper resume. Remember, a resume is your first introduction to that institution. So all of these things, they're gaining the opportunity to. We actually have a gentleman, or a young man, I should say, who is currently going through the GED program at within the prison system, and his time for release is coming up. Guess what? He's asking if he could stay longer so he can complete his GED.
Behind bars. Wow.
He feels like that in that environment, he's going to be able to stay focused. He appreciates
really?
The type of support that he's getting from Dr. Boston and Dr. Pierre. And so they, you know, he wants to remain there so he can achieve this and come out into his new life with his diploma.
Okay, that's basically saying he doesn't want to be distracted.
No.
Yeah,
right?
The
Isn't
distraction.
That amazing?
The distraction. It's kind of crazy, but it's
yeah.
But no, in a sense of, you know, like everybody looks forward to leaving, getting out of prison.
Yeah, but if you know what your environment
right,
is like, if you come out,
exactly. That's
I think
what I
he's
mean,
just
you know?
Trying to
the
align.
Distraction.
Yeah, he's trying to align himself that when he comes out, he is going to be in a better position. That, you know, he feels stronger and be able to go toward a job. So I compliment his thought process.
Our young people are basically looking for likes on social media by getting mm-hmm. themselves involved in all kind of fights. We see 15 and 16 year olds being carted off to prison or just the cell basically at such a young age already with a police record.
Yeah, it's a
pity. How did we get to this? I mean, you know, it's not only just you take a young girl and you beat her up, all you basically you jump her in a house. But also we see a lot of this happening around the, on the school premises and in the vicinity of the schools also.
Yeah.
Everywhere for that matter.
Yeah. I think parents really have to account for the behavior of the children. But at the same time, a child could be raised in a really good household. But when you're outdoors or you're not in the eye of your parents, you are a whole different person.
Mm-hmm.
So we cannot put all the onus on a parent. But at the same time, we need to be able to have that parental involvement, because you also do have those children where the parents are not involved at all. You have children who are acting out because of circumstances that they are encountering.
Mm-hmm.
But again, I always say that the approach when it comes to our children is one that is multifaceted. So you have to have parents, schools, social support. There is so many different arms that needs to play a role in making sure that our social system, our children, are being raised in an environment and in society that is one that is protecting, but one that is positive as well. We see adults conducting themselves in less becoming ways, and children mimic that as well. The manner in which you conduct yourselves on social media, children are paying attention to that, and they're mimicking it as well. So as a society, we have a lot of work to do, and we have to stop this belief that the Ministry of Justice is all and be all. Mm-hmm. Ministry of Justice is not the ministry that is responsible to fix this. Yeah, we play a hand in it. We give a support to it, but we're the back end. The front end needs to really reevaluate what's happening and come up with opportunities to be able to address this. Now, you also have instances, and I go back to parents, where sometimes parents are approached about the behavior of their children, and they themselves act out. They themselves display a way of not recognizing that, let's say, for example, if a teacher or the school says, hey, I'm having challenges with your child, you know, before some parents will deal with the child, they would make the teacher the problem.
Right.
You know what I mean? And so, and do that in front of the child. You know, I remember when my children were much younger and I would have those instances, I would send my sons away, you know, and I would have that conversation with that teacher
one-on-one,
never in front of my kids, because you do not disrespect your teacher. You know what I mean?
Right.
If you tell me that the teacher did such and such and I'm not in agreement, then the teacher and I need to have that conversation, but not in front of the child,
right?
Because I'm going to reprimand my son, but at the same time, I'm going to let that teacher know my son didn't fall out of the sky. So the manner in which you treat him, I'm asking you, you have him for X amount of hours a day. Let's work together to make sure that we are raising this young man in the proper way. But Don't belittle him. Don't make him feel like, you know, if he's wrong, let's deal with it accordingly. But you have some parents that are ready to fight the teachers in front of the children.
And that makes the student also
empowers
him to disrespect the teacher.
So we need to be able to look as to the dynamics of what's happening between parents, children, teachers, and other, you know, forms of authority. Because some of the children, they want to fight police.
We saw that.
You know what I mean? So where is that coming from?
Right.
Right?
We had it, and it's good that you mentioned that, because I just want you to take your gloves off for a minute here. And let's talk about what we've seen that happened last week and the Causeway Jump Up, where we had some fights, of course, where there were shootings, there were stabbings. You last year, I believe, a year or two ago,
it was last year,
you made mention of wearing these face coverings, that you were totally against it. A lot of people actually, you know, they were totally against that. And now we see that the KPSM, the police force, is actually enforcing it at every jump up.
And they've also gotten indication from my person under directive, you know, we don't need to wait for several incidents to happen. You know, we had wrong town jump up.
Right.
I indicated and I stressed it. The first incident, shut it down. Shut it down. Don't wait for any others.
Thank you.
And that is the attitude at any event. We don't need for them to feel like, they just brush it off. Stop the music. Stop the jam. Mm-hmm. Everybody go home.
There you go.
The point of carnival is for us to let our hair down, have a good time, have fun. So if you're not coming out to have fun, then you don't need to be in this environment. This is not, you know, just saving it up, because some people do that. Some of these young ones, they do it. They wait until these events are happening to bring harm to others. It's not funny. It's not cute. Everybody is somebody's child. Everybody is someone's loved one, just like you are, right? Mm-hmm. And so that is not the premise or the place for any of this. Nowhere is good to bring harm to anyone, but we're not going to support, and I commend KPSM for not even waiting for me to tell them that, but just enforcing it as again, you know,
and it does.
But honestly speaking, at any function that there is, the moment that they have any type of altercations and disruptions, and especially in this, shut it down.
I like that. Yeah, we saw that actually with the Friendside Juve. I think there was a shooting, and I think they just cut it off.
Yeah, but it shouldn't even have to arrive to that.
Because right.
Especially in a setting like that, oftentimes it is bystanders who will end up getting injured because you're wild. You're mm-hmm. wild in this situation.
Wilding out.
Yeah, but let's go out and have a good time.
All right.
A safe time.
Back in 2018, Minister, you signed a 5-year contract with the SCDF. I'm sorry I have to bring that up. To host all 4 pageants. Talk to us. Walk us through that room.
You're asking me to switch hats now, Grace?
That's what I want you to do. That's what I want you to do, the radio listeners. And I'm sure SCDF is listening too.
Tell me your question again.
Again, back in 2018, you signed a 5-year contract with SCDF to host all 4 pageants.
Correct.
And so, how did that go? Because I believe there was even mention that I saw on social media that one person actually said that after you left, that some of the prizes that were to be awarded to winners of there was Posh Productions, I believe, were never paid, and it was sad, and the SCDF was saddened with that.
Wow. Okay, so
let's clear the air here, because we're going in now. Let me make it that we're going in on it right now, so you could just take off your minister hat for a minute, because we got to go into this. Because we also got to find out about the signing of the handing of a permit and everything else that's been out there on social media.
Yes,
so let's start with the Posh Productions first.
Yes, indeed. So Posh did sign an agreement. It was a case I got a call, I believe it was, and I was advised that they were thinking to outsource the pageants. No problem. This was actually a dream come true for me, because being a 3-time title holder myself, you know, pageantry is something that I absolutely love. I believe pageantry goes way beyond what it seems in terms of the glitz and the glamour, but your ability to articulate, your confidence level, you know, being able to exert a talent and memory all at once, you know, it's the one sport that you have to literally be able to speak and answer a question on a whim.
Mm-hmm.
Nevertheless, that opportunity was given. The proposal, I wrote up the proposal myself, designed everything of Posh myself. I proposed it to the SCDF. A few weeks later, I was advised that Posh is the successful winner of that bid, you can call it. Submitted or I received a contractual agreement, and you know, within that contractual agreement, one of the things that stands out of it, Grace, is that you are to recoup your investment at the gate. You will recoup your investment at the gate. Very, very, very important. Other aspects of it is things like, you know, you will be provided with stage, you will be provided with sound, light, security, these things, right? So those are costs that you do not have to come out of pocket as a promoter or producing. So when you host these pageants, right? Well, let me go back a little bit more. Remember that the pageants are called the Telcel pageants, right? Now, one cannot approach Telcel before signing an agreement, because what conversation is Telcel having with you if you do not have anything that says you indeed have this responsibility? So I had to wait until that signed contract. And then I approached Telcel and I said, hey, listen, Posh is carrying these pageants, you know. So when it comes to the sponsorship, then I would see to it that it comes to Posh. And they said, well, you do not, or Telcel does not have a contract or any type of agreement with Posh. That is with the SCDF, so you would have to speak to the SCDF. And that is where my understanding came about, that any sponsorship that would have come from Telem or Telcel would have gone directly to the SCDF. When you approach SCDF, SCDF is telling you, nobody gave us money for you. No one gave us money for you. You understand?
Proceed.
But you know that within the proposal that was submitted to Telcel, the pageants are included. So that's one reality check. Wow, so how am I going to go about getting funding? And then when you go to each different institution, they're telling you, we've already given to the SCDF. We've already given. So you go to SCDF and you're like, hey, everybody is saying, and they're like, everybody does say that. Not true, you know? Mm-hmm. So here you go now and you're thinking, well, I'm going to have to tap into my own resources.
Who's telling you this?
SCDF is telling you that no money is given to them for any other, institution. So you have to tap into your own funding now, because you're working on the premise that the contract says you're going to recoup at the gate. Now that you come to the night of the pageant and your head treasurer is telling you, at the end of the night, we didn't make any money. And you're going, what do you mean? The village full. Your village is full. And then you start to realize that everybody's coming in on season passes. Be it that they bought the passes or they were given the passes. That's the reality. Yeah. And this went on for some time. Back and forth conversations, trying to get them to realize.
You brought this to their attention.
Of course. Of
what
course.
Was the reaction?
Numerous times. As I stated, mm-hmm. no one gave us funding for you.
Right. But when you actually told them, listen, I have 5,000 people in the village, but I've only sold 2,000 tickets.
Yes, the answer is we didn't have any agreement with you with regards to the season passes. And nothing in your agreement says that they're going to be giving you any funds.
Refund.
No, nothing says that. So you find yourself in a bind. And, you know, I am somebody who anything that I sign up to do, I do 110%. Mm-hmm. I put my all into it. So when I signed that agreement, it wasn't just with the SCDF, but it was to the people of St. Maarten who is now looking forward to these pageants, especially after the level that we brought the pageants to the first year. Mm-hmm. Like, persons were looking forward to these pageants, right? So you have this obligation, and then it's a case where we had a, I don't remember what it is occurred, and we didn't end up having the pageants 1 year. Mm-hmm. And then it was a case that we came back online. But when we came back online, we were advised that we're not in the festival village. The pageants are put outside the festival village. So now,
but that's not stated in the contract.
It's not stated in the contract. Thank you for saying that. Because now that means I have to find stage, lighting, security, sound, and everything. So you're not making the money at the gate from the years that you lost.
So this is an added expense.
This is an added expense. You're not getting the support from them, right? And then everybody is going, where are my prizes? But it's difficult for us to be able, because now you're all vendors as well. Mm-hmm. So you keep sinking further and further into a financial hole, mm-hmm. right? And then when we, you know, just not to go too long in it, but I'm just giving the understanding of how you sink in this hole. And then when you're going to sponsors, you start to realize that sponsors are looking at you on the side eye. And then you're hearing, but the way the SCDF speaks about you is very negative.
Stop.
So Posh has a very negative name.
Stop.
Right? But what did Posh exactly do other than
did you ask them why?
Go into an agreement, right? To be able to bring forward our pageants. Pageants are part of our cultural mm-hmm. formula within our annual national carnival, mm-hmm. right? And I hold pageantry very dear to my heart. So of course, me being me, I want to put the best foot out there. So I'm not the type of person to run to social media and, you know, write up negative things. And I don't believe in that. So I did seek to get some legal support in this. Mm-hmm. And several of the law firms that I went to, it was like letters going back and forth, and then it would drop. There are those who would tell you they're not, you know, they're not going to take the case. There are those who are telling you. The last lawyer that I dealt with had me pay him over $2,000 up front. Pay me $2,000. This is a winnable case. Going to get this going mm-hmm. for you. So pay him the money. He writes a letter to the SCDF. SCDF writes back to my person. And maybe a week or two later, wrote back to him. A week or two later, he says to me, I'm going to be running on a political slate, and it's a conflict of interest for me to continue to represent you. So I can't represent you any further. I said, okay, fine. Can I have my refund? He said, no, I already did the work that I had to do.
Wow.
You know, those are the things you experience. And then you hear about, you know, all the different passes that gets distributed to the different entities, and you realize, oh, so that's why you won't represent. That's mm-hmm. why, because there's a benefit in it. But you know, Grace, at the end of the day, I see that there is a lot of finger pointing to my person about, let's say, for example, the fact that the senior queen show is not happening this year. It's the Minister of Justice's fault. Really? How so? I can immediately understand when the young ladies are saying they can't get sponsorship. Yes, because one entity is eating up the market. You know, how do you have boot holders, you have producers of shows, you have contestants and Calypsonians? In order for those shows to happen, those individuals need to secure funding. And if they cannot get the financing because everybody is hearing the same story that they've already given to this one institution, mm-hmm. how are they supposed to be able to take part? you know? So it's interesting to me. But
you granting a permit is something actually during Carnival that is something that a lot of people wasn't aware of, that it was not in the law that it was prohibited to do that.
It's not. SCDF owns Carnival.
So it's always been there.
Of course. It is a case where historically you would see, it seems as though individuals themselves with political persons and party to protect the ability of, during Carnival, don't give any permits. But legally, what is the base to not? At the end of the day, it's an institution that's saying we have a festive production to do. And like you know, I heard Skelet on your interview.
Yes,
you
yes.
Know?
He and strongly defends you.
Yeah. Skelet was on your interview and he says, listen, we put in our permit request since November and we got it in February. He said the minister studied. Oh, I sure bet did. I sure bet did review and I asked my questions and I asked my legal to be able to advise me what is what. And when I pay attention, right, to the fact that we know annually the platforms that will produce, be it Flag Fest, be it Bacchanal Sunday, mm-hmm. be it Night of the Hitmakers and so forth. And you know these individuals are not a part of the lineup, but you can see the intellectual property being, you know, properly printed there. Is government supposed to facilitate that? Is government supposed to back you up by denying you a permit that there's no legal basis or reason? There's no threat. See, the Minister of Justice can deny a request for a demonstration or if there is reasoning to believe that this is going to turn violent or something of the sort, right? Okay, so Carnival is one of those exceptions where we know that incidences happen, but we also have the authority where we tell the police to shut it down, right? But in this instance, what would be the reason that the minister would tell the person, you can't have your event, to be able to protect the wrongdoings that we see happening?
This is outside the festival.
Outside. We have the strip. Everybody talks about how lit the strip this be, and everybody's outside because it's more affordable, etc. Now, boot holders, of course, you would want to be able to ensure that, you know, people are going into the festival village. But do you also dictate where persons go to enjoy themselves? Like, this is our carnival season. It's festive. If you want to be inside, it'd be outside. No one said anything to Mr. Rude.
Right.
He's having his event during Carnival as well. No one said anything about Mr. Rude. So is it a case that if Bacchanal Sunday and Flag Fest was being kept at a venue, there would be no sound about it? Mm-hmm. But it's easy to blame the minister. It's easy to blame government. You know what? The experience with the SCDF, even in this capacity as minister, we would see the articles they write in the paper. We would hear them on the radio. We would see them commenting on Facebook. It has been nothing but utterly disrespectful. And that disrespect does not stop with government, doesn't stop with me. It is also the same manner in which they conduct with promoters, with boot holders, with anyone who approaches them and say, hey, listen, your manner in operation or how you're doing business is one that is affecting me negatively. It's very dismissive. It's very disrespectful. Mm-hmm. But as minister, everything that I do, I see what the legal basis is and I work within the parameters of the law. There is nothing that is giving me reason to deny these individuals their permit. But I'm also not going to participate in destroying others for one entity mm-hmm. who has, Don Hughes, where is he as a promoter?
PJ2,
gone, right? Mr. Cool took the SCDF to court and won for these same types of practices.
Clarence Derby.
There is so many. Now Mr. Rude is out. They're out. 78 Inc. out. We are all natives of this country and we all believe in Carnival. We all want to be a part of it, but you cannot continue to treat people the way you are and expect me in this capacity as minister to support that.
You open a floodgate here now, because basically what we're seeing is that this is just the start of something that probably other promoters will be saying the same thing for next Carnival too. Is like, oh yeah, well, it happened last year. I could do it next year too.
For me,
because there is no law
for
that
me,
protects us or prevents us from hosting an event outside of the
yeah. Okay? It all begins with the SCDF. Kick people out of the village when it is convenient for you. And then when situations like this come up, you want to blame the government. Government has been one that is non-cooperative to sensationalize. They know how to write an article and sensationalize the public so that the public can rise up against the minister. There was one of the things that happened last year, and I've been so silent about it, Grace. Police are not allowed to come in the festival village.
Oh, yes, I
minister, stop that. Picked up the phone and I called Chief John and I said, Chief, you and I had a conversation about officers going into the village. He said, no, minister, this is what happened. He says, as management, we said to officers, if you are not on duty, do not abuse going into the festival village with your police pass, especially if an incident is going to take place and you're not going to support your colleagues because you're off. I said, oh, but the Minister of Justice is being, yes, Minister, but SCDF is the one that is saying that, not us. Yes? So SCDF picked it up and he did it again this year. The Minister of Justice, such a blatant lie. The festival, that is management who knows how their operation runs, who knows what their officers do, and are telling the officers, do not abuse your pass by doing that. But it is so convenient in our political arena, our political environment, to bash the minister and make the minister out to be the worst person that is in prohibiting carnival from being what it needs to be. But what I want to see is that carnival happens the way that it should. I know we have a lot of boot holders, historical boot holders that are now on the strip, right? There's a reason for that. Government is not responsible. As a matter of fact, compliments to the Ministry of TEA, because I was made to understand that is the ministry that makes it possible for the strip to even be in existence. But there's so many festivities that is already happening outside of kind of out of the village.
And you mentioned the Ministry of TEA. I just heard a minister mention last week in Parliament that the funding of carnival should actually be going towards the Ministry of Culture and not TEA.
Agreed. There was an approach for us to be able to bring a committee within government because, first of all, Grace, Carnival belongs to the people of Sint Maarten. That's one. The government of Sint Maarten is representing the people of Sint Maarten, and we concession out, government concessions out the hosting of Carnival to an entity, in this case, a foundation. Listen, we even had the Sint Maarten Development Fund do a complete historical review of where Carnival started. As a matter of fact, I even noticed on one of the flyers for Carnival that it is not even calling the festival the Carnival Village its proper name.
Okay.
That government named it, the Arnel Festival Village. It's
right.
Not being called that.
By Minister of Romania.
Yes, exactly.
Right.
That in itself, that government did, is not being respected because I saw the flyers and it doesn't recognize the name. So again, a blatant disrespect to the government of Sint Maarten by
and
this
to the family
organization.
Of Mr. Jocelyn.
Thank
also.
You. You see what I'm saying? So at the end of the day, when you can't simply recognize that government is the entity that is to manage, that owns Carnival for the people of Sint Maarten, that says a lot. It doesn't matter how long you have been in this capacity. You've made it possible to be because you align yourself with political persons as you go to be able to protect the manner, your way of doing business that actually hurts so many people. There are so many persons within our community who loves Carnival but stays away from it because they have been burned or they just recognize that it is no longer about culture. And we need to bring that back. Look at Aruba Carnival. Look at Aruba Carnival.
I just came from there.
So, I saw your pictures. So beautiful, right?
Yes, yes.
So large, so beautiful. At the end of the day, that is what we want for Sint Maarten as well, And so we need to be able to recognize that government does not have to bow down to entities that are given the opportunity to do something on the behalf of Sint Maarten.
You think Carnival should go on bid? That was something that was proposed a few years ago.
I do, because the SCDF does not own Carnival. Like I said, the government of Sint Maarten is the entity that is responsible for that. But government has a responsibility to recognize that a formation of representatives from each ministry that is affected. Vromi has to put up barriers and provide justice. We provide the enforcement, mm-hmm. safety and security, and the overtime hours that costs the government of Sint Maarten is something that doesn't even come into close proximity as to what the SCDF would have to pay for a permit mm-hmm. to host an event. The Ministry of Tayat needs to see to it that we are promoted on that. And so different ministries have to come with representatives. And within that, you have sub-representation. Somebody is representing the boot holders, somebody representing the pageants, somebody representing the Calypsonians. So everybody's interest is recognized, and then the conversation happens with the foundation that is with the concession mm-hmm. to host said carnival. But this attitude, like everybody is insignificant and only what you say goes, and everybody must bow down to you, is not something that I can honor. Very sorry.
You're right. The situation actually is playing out on social media.
Mm-hmm.
And as we see it right now, that you have three of the major promoters, actually, they will be hosting their events, and they already have their tickets out on sale. So is this basically setting the stage for what's to come for Carnival in the future here in Sint Maarten?
It's either that, or it would be a case that it would be a wake-up call to individuals to treat people better.
Mm-hmm.
You know, do right by the individuals who want to be a part of Carnival. And I heard Skelet say it, plus I read it, because he made a post and he tagged
yes,
me in it,
keeps,
where
he says,
I asked for a mm-hmm. discussion. So you would ask for a discussion, and in that discussion, you just want to be able to come to a consensus. Let's come to a common ground. But if you continue to treat people like as though they're insignificant, they're going to find other ways and means to be able to do. And I just do not believe that it is government's role and responsibility to support wrongdoings being done against others. And you know what, Grace? I would be a total hypocrite. I would be a total hypocrite to be well aware of how things happen and still choose to go against what the law says and not grant.
Mm-hmm.
Total hypocrite.
Are you concerned about the security aspect of these events that will be held outside of the festival?
I'm glad you asked that, because I also heard that there is this statement going around that, you know, KPSM advised negative. That is incorrect. The advice is right there, and they did not have any objection to the Kalaboom events that were put forward. It was a positive, and that in itself as well, coupled in with the fact that when you study the entire thing, when I look at, let's say, for example, what the SCDF presented to us, let's talk about the 27th of May in particular, which is Juve Morning. Juve Morning, the documents we have, is the only event on that schedule. So we were like, oh, okay, cool. So that Juve Morning happens in the morning, mm-hmm. but in the night, Kalaboom is having their event on the 27th. We're good to go.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So all of that was looked at.
Mm-hmm.
There's a statement, and SCDF puts it out, and the Herald has it, that the minister issued a permit for May 3rd. Where is that? Please produce that permit for May 3rd. Stop lying to the community of Sint Maarten.
Gaslighting.
Gaslighting it is. Stop lying to the people of Sint Maarten. You know what I mean? But my shoulders are broad, and I recognize what is happening, and it's fine. Those who know better know that, you know, all that is being put out there is not entirely true. And for years, people have been crying about the operations and the way that this institution does business. And I really hope that, you know, the incoming government and even our parliamentarians right now will not allow this level of disrespect and to some extent abuse to continue to happen to the patrons of Sint Maarten, to the people who dedicate themselves, be it money, you know, the investment you make to put on a good production and for people to come and enjoy themselves. That should be something that we do together. We celebrate together. Not that you are making it difficult for others just so you can take their name and run with it, you know, and put on a production, giving the impression that they're still in formation with you. Don't do that.
Yeah.
You know? Don't do that. But, hey.
Minister, You are awesome. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And from speaking from the justice part to right down to basically taking your gloves off and sharing the information with us regarding your reason.
I can switch my hat.
Come back and let's sign off.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you so much for coming in this morning. Yes. I want to thank the radio listeners, of course, for tuning in and our viewers, of course, on your Facebook page as well. Closing statements.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for having me here. Thank you to the people of Sint Maarten. I know that my way of being a minister might have been new for some persons, but I ultimately my goal here in Sint Maarten is to be able to serve my community. And we talk about wanting to see proper change in our community, proper change in leadership. And I could do nothing else but be my genuine self. I'm grateful for the hard work that me and my team did. I did not do this alone as minister. I have a lot of people to thank. They know who they are. I do it all the time. I'm sure we're short for time, so I can't state everybody, but I'm truly, truly, genuinely grateful for the team that I've had, be it partners, even external legal support, and other entities that have been supported to the Ministry of Justice. Success to all the personnel of the Ministry of Justice. We will continue with our LBA signing until the day that I'm no longer in this capacity as minister.
All right,
perfectly
said.
Thank you for having me.
And thank you so much. Thank you again to the radio listeners and also your Facebook viewers. And that's going to wrap it up for yours. Truly want to thank Joanne also this morning for bearing with us. The news is up next, and we'll see you all back here tomorrow morning once again from 7 until 10.